Hallelujah. 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 Glory. Glory. Hallelujah. Glory in this place. Hallelujah. Before they call me pastor, they call me minister of music. Come on, let's get ready to praise God. Let's get ready to praise God. We praise your name. Come on and praise it. Welcome to Empower One Word Ministries. Hallelujah. We are at 7537 Old Alexandria Ferry Road in Clinton, Maryland. This is the place where you receive the unfiltered word of God. This is the place where we simply say what God tells us to say. This is not a place of judgment, for none of us can cast any stones. This is not a place for anything except the love of Jesus Christ. That's what we do. This is a place where you can learn how to take the word and apply it to your everyday life, beginning not next week, not by and by, but today. If you'll simply take it piece by piece, message by message, and start to put this thing together, it'll create a change in your life. Tonight is a special night for me, just like last Wednesday was. Glory to God. I have the honor and privilege of introducing and moving out of the way and allowing the woman that God gave me and you to come and teach us in Bible study. I can't wait to get to my seat. I've been waiting all week. Glory to God. Hallelujah. I've been waiting all week since last week. God has put a word into the heart and mouth of the co-pastor, Deborah Purcell. Like so many of us, everything in her life hasn't always gone perfectly. But like only a few of us, she has the courage to believe God in spite of everything around her speaking to the contrary. The enemy is doing everything that he can to keep her from bringing forth this word. He's doing everything that he can to stop her from standing up here bringing forth this word. He's been trying to discourage her. He's been trying to distract her. He's been raising her blood pressure, and we're going to go ahead and rebuke that right now in the name of Jesus, since I got about two or three witnesses. We're going to rebuke the spirit of high blood pressure. He's been doing a lot of things to distract her. But what you're going to find tonight is what the enemy finds out every day. Here she come again. The next voice that you hear will be that of co-pastor Deborah Purcell.
Amen. Yeah, it's working. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Welcome into this place. Lord, I give you honor and glory, and I give you all praise. I ask, Lord God, that you would use me tonight to bring forth what it is that you would have the people to learn, Lord, to know, Lord, so that they can go forth. So that they can go forth walking stronger and bolder in you, Lord God. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to read the word to you tonight from the Psalms 27. I'm reading from the New International Version. Say amen when you get there. Amen. We're starting at verse 13. I remain confident of this. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord. Be strong and take heart and wait for the Lord. Amen. Tonight, I want to talk to you about Rachel and Leah. These are sisters who you'll find in the book of Genesis, chapter 29. Leah was the older sister and Rachel was the younger. They were shepherd people. Their dad owned a lot of sheep. Leah was older, and Leah was not as pretty. They said that she had a lazy eye. So I think that means she was cross-eyed. And Rachel was beautiful. So there was contrast. They were total opposites. Their father was kind of a slickster, though, because Rachel had fallen in love with, and Jacob had fallen in love with her. They had met each other out there at the well watering sheep. And it's like love at first sight. So Jacob was working for Laban, her father, and they had agreed that if he worked 7 years, he'd have Rachel. So he worked 7 years, no conflict, saying nothing. Thank you. Glory to God. Can you hear me? He had worked 7 years, no complaints, just working, 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 making her father more successful and richer. And at the end of 7 years, he says, okay, it's time. I've done my work. It's time. So the custom was that when you got married, you would go in to the tent and be with your new wife, and then y'all party for a week to celebrate, and it was just this awesome thing. The problem was that Laban had decided that it wasn't going to be Rachel, it was going to be Leah. Leah was the older sister, and in Laban's mind, and I guess in the way that things were back then, it was right for the older sister to get married first. So Jacob was tricked into marrying Leah. Well, what's funny about that is that Jacob was a trickster, so he got tricked by the trickster. Because he was one who had already cheated his brother out of his birthright. He had a twin brother that he had cheated out of his birthright. So it's like, okay, what goes around comes around. He got tricked out of, he got tricked out of his Rachel. So he had Leah, who he did not love. Can you imagine being married to somebody who does not love you? And he did not have, it's like he didn't make any bones about it. He didn't love her. He felt tricked. And that happens in today's world where people just kind of trick you into something that you don't want to be in. It doesn't even have to be marriage. It could be something else. They could tell you the job is one thing and you get there and it's something else. They could tell you that you have a scale of pay that's going to be here and you get there and there's no way you can reach it. So that's the kind of stuff that happens, and that's what was going on here, where he had done all the stuff that he said he was going to do. And Laban, the father-in-law, didn't do any of what he said. He said, okay, you got me. Now what? So what he said was, okay, you've got Leah, so go do your week-long partying, and then I'll give you Rachel. So after a week, he said, give me Rachel. He says, oh, no, you got to work 7 years for her. So so here we go. He got to work another 7 years. But he loved Rachel. He loved her. So as much as he loved Rachel, that's how much he did not love Leah. Now imagine poor Leah. She's sitting there. Her daddy has had to trick somebody into marrying her. She's got a crooked eye. So it's just, her whole world is like weary like that. And her name means weary. She's unloved. And that's her affliction. She has that, you know, haven't you met people who just look like they were just sad? Like people just don't, they just don't feel loved. It doesn't mean that they're not loved. Because what you'll find is that Leah was loved. She just didn't feel loved. She felt unloved because her husband didn't love her. At the same time, though, she was, although he didn't love her, she was having babies. Well, after the 7 years, Jacob finally got his Rachel, who he loved, loved, loved. Well, Leah was having babies, but Rachel was not having any babies. And back in that time, it was seen as a curse if you were not having babies. You married and not having babies. You were barren. So it's like the Lord did not have his eyes on you. Leah was having babies. All in all, before the end of the story, she's had 7 babies by this man who did not love her. Now, what does that say? It said, you know what it says? I remember seeing this somewhere. It says that, because let me get it right. It's not biblical, but it flows with what the Bible says. Because you have sex doesn't make him yours. And because you have babies doesn't make him yours. And it definitely won't make him stay. Because what as you go through the story, this story is in Genesis 29, so when you get home you can read Genesis 29. what you'll see is that they were living together. Back in there, it was back in that day, men had several wives, as many as they could afford to have. So he had these two wives, and he also had two maidens, because they were like competing against each other instead of being the loving sisters that they should have been. So they each gave him their maid servant too. So in all, he had four wives. He was having children by these people too. He had seven babies by Leah. He had in all 12 babies. As you go through the Bible, you'll hear about the 12 tribes of Israel. These were his 12 children, his 12 sons. And out of Judah, which was one of Leah's sons, came Jesus. So you see, she was blessed. She just didn't feel blessed. So you can be in a place mentally and emotionally where you're not looking up and seeing the perspective from where maybe you should look, because what was happening was she was being blessed. It was a blessing to have children. She was having children, whereas her sister wasn't. Her sister was jealous of her, so her sister was making her feel bad. Because remember, Rachel was beautiful, and Leah had a cross eye. So you've got that issue, and then you've got the issue of self-esteem because her husband does not love her. So and I don't know, Jacob was a trickster, but somewhere in there, Jacob came to really know the Lord. The Lord changed his name to Israel, and there was a change in him then too. But it did not change the fact that he loved Rachel. And you know, that happens in life where people try to do things. They're just going to make you want a certain thing or be a certain way. And that's just not the way that it is. I'm going to make you love me. Well, isn't there a song about that? I'm going to make you love me. I'm going to make you give me this job that I don't even qualify for. I'm going to make you be a certain way. I'm going to make you act a certain way. It's like it's a spirit of control when they try to make you. If you study that, that's a spirit of witchcraft where they try to make you be something other than what you are or what you want to be. But poor Rachel had an affliction because she wanted her husband to love her. As much as he did not love her, that's how much she wanted him to love her. You can tell because she was, even the names that she named her kids says, she was just pining over the fact that this man doesn't love her. She was not looking at the fact that the Lord was blessing her. She was not looking at the fact that her life may have been even something different than what it was. Did her father have to marry her off? I don't know. But I know that it was a blessing for her to be married in that time. But she didn't see it that way. She wanted him to love her, and there was nothing else was going to be good enough. Now, Rachel had a similar dilemma. He loved her, but she wanted babies and couldn't have babies. And she wanted babies so bad that that's when she gave one of her maids to say, okay, maybe the maid can have a baby with you and it'll be my baby because it's my maid. I don't know how that worked in her head, but that's what she did. She was jealous of Leah because Leah was having babies. Leah was jealous of her because Jacob loved Rachel. So here we are when they were sisters. So what they should have been doing was lifting each other up. Imagine what would happen if we changed perspective when things aren't going the way that we would want them to go. Imagine if we would turn and help somebody else who may be in a similar situation. Because there was nothing they could do about it. Their father married them off, and that was a time, in that time, that's what you did. Your father married you off. So they were both in a place that Rachel would have chosen it, but I don't know that Leah would have chosen that place. But because they were there, even though they were sisters, they were not helping each other. They were jealous of each other. So what it said was, I don't know why Jacob wasn't finding a way to make the situation better. Maybe because he just did not love Leah. Because remember, he felt tricked. Isn't that something that he would mistreat her and it wasn't her fault? That's what happens too. It's like when we lose our perspective, we do things that we wouldn't otherwise do. We also will put up with things that we wouldn't otherwise put up with. Sometimes there are people who are in situations that they can get out of, but they just won't because they can't see themselves. They can't see themselves taking the step to get out of it. And there's nothing that would say, okay, Leah, maybe if she had prayed for something other than that he love her. Because I believe that God saw that, was jealous, because God is a jealous God. She was putting all of her strength and energy in loving Jacob and making Jacob love her, that she was not acknowledging the blessing that was on her life. She was not acknowledging all these children that she was having. Jesus came out of her son, Judah. Now, what kind of blessing is that? It's like we look at things, but we can't see past the thing. We can't see the meaning behind it. We can't see the why. Sometimes we're in a situation to learn something. Sometimes we're in a situation to help somebody else learn something. Because remember, these are two sisters. They could have been helping each other. They could have been finding a way that together it's okay. But instead, they were battling each other. They were trying to make each other jealous. There was at one point where Leah was so pitiful that she asked Rachel, can he come and stay with me tonight? Because it was obvious that, okay, Leah had her tent over here, Rachel had her tent over here. And Jacob loved Rachel, so that's where he was. And she wanted to, one of Leah's sons had been out picking apples. And this apple was supposed to be good for helping women get pregnant. So Rachel wanted the apple. And so Rachel asked her, Rachel says, okay, if you'll give me some of your son's apples, I'll let him come sleep with you tonight. And Leah, as pathetic as that sounds, agreed. So Jacob went in and stayed with Leah that night, but it did not change the fact that he did not love her. He did that because his wife that he loved asked him to do it. She was jealous and still jealous that Leah had a son who loved her enough to come and give her, to bring her apples. Can you imagine? She had six sons and a daughter. Can you imagine how much they loved her? Looking at their father not love her? But she couldn't see that blessing. All she could see was what she didn't have versus what she did have. I would ask that what you do this week is go home and figure out what you do have. Because all of us have something that we want that we don't have. But Rachel was one who always wanted what she didn't have. She always wanted what everybody else had. She couldn't see that she had a man who loved her bigger than love can be imagined. But what she wanted was what somebody else had. She wanted what poor Leah had with the cross eye. Let me just take your fruit too. There was at one point where Jacob had decided that he was ready to leave their father's land, that he was going to go back to his own land. And so he gathered up his two wives and his two concubines, who were the maids of the wives, and all these children. And he was going back, taking his family back. Well, Rachel, who's always wanting what everybody else has, stole some of her father's idols. It was like they had these things in the house, idols. I guess like golden whatnots. So she stole them. And when Laban figured out that those things were gone, he chased after them because he thought that Jacob already took his daughters and all the sheep that he had. Then he says, you got my idols too. Well, Jacob didn't know that the idols were there, so he said, no, I don't have them. But Rachel hid the idols. But that brought a curse on her because for idolatry, it brought a curse on her. But her whole life was about idolatry because it was about she wanted what everybody else had. She was never satisfied with what she had. She was never satisfied with the grace that God had put on her, given her a man who really, truly loved her in a time where, as you can see with Leah, he could be married to you and not have to love you or nothing. She wanted what other people had. She wasn't satisfied with what she had. And she was just this kind of a person who was, she was bitter because she couldn't have children. And finally, she had a son. She had Joseph. Even then, she wasn't satisfied. You would think that after having a baby, you know how people are after having, trying, and then they have a baby, how grateful they should be and how much they should be glorifying God because of this miracle. She named him Joseph. And as I studied, I learned that Joseph means to add another. So she didn't hang on long enough to be thankful for that one before saying, okay, give me another one. She was just one of those people who just wasn't grateful, dissatisfied, always wanting more. And it was about having more. It was about, okay, I'm Rachel, so I should have more. Give me more, give me more. Never thankful, never stopping long enough to be thankful for what she did have. But somewhere along the line, their husband changed. This is the one, remember the song, Climbing Jacob's Ladder? He's the one who one night he just started to wrestle with God because he wanted the blessing of God, and he was just wrestling with God until he says, I'm not going to let you go until I get this blessing. I want you to bless me, bless me, bless me. So it's like his heart was being changed because this was a man who knew of God before, but he really wanted to know God. Just bless me, bless me, bless me. And he wrestled with God to the point where God blessed him and changed his name to Israel from Jacob, because Jacob means trickster. And that's how he was. He was a hustle man initially and got hustled. This is a hustle man who got hustled, and now he had to live with the hustle that he got. He had to live with Leah, who he could, every day that he looked at her, she could see in his eyes what he thought. Now, can you imagine having that kind of a life where you are in a place where you feel like you can't go anywhere, you can't do anything, and you just have to suffer the degradation of having somebody look at you and see disgust, having somebody come in and lay with you and have babies now? But when it's time to go show love, he goes to the next tent. That happens today. There are women today who settle for being the woman across town. They settle for being, and then there are wives who settle for letting their husbands go across town. And it's what has to happen is they both have to find the strength from the Lord to say, I am God's child and I don't deserve this. I am God's child and I claim the love of the Lord. Because when you put your eyes on the Lord, it's like he will bring those things to pass. And you can tell that that's what happened with Leah, because as she started having these babies, at first the babies were, you could tell that she was still pining over Jacob's not loving her by the way that she named the babies. The first one was Reuben, and that means behold a son. It's like, okay, I've given you this son. Surely you're going to love me now. Behold, a son. And it was a huge deal back in the day. Even today, oh, son versus daughter. Behold, a son. But that did not make him love her. The next one was named Simeon. And his name means to be heard. So it's like what she's saying is, God, I'm praying to you, but you don't hear me. And sometimes God is, his silence is speaking. I really, really had to go deep with that, because I've been there where it's like, okay, God, you're silent. I don't hear you. I don't know what you're saying. I don't know that you're here. I can't hear. I don't see you. I'm blind. It's black. I don't see you. I don't hear you. I don't know. I don't know if I'm doing something wrong, if I'm not doing something right. I don't hear you. Sometimes God's silence is speaking. Sometimes he's saying, be patient. Sometimes he's saying, remember what I last said and go back to that. Sometimes I even have to pray, Lord, I can't remember what you last said. Please tell me. I'm just real. I don't know. But there are moments where it seems that God is just silent. You wonder what's going on in your life. You know that your life is not on the path that you thought it would be on. It doesn't mean it's on the wrong path. It just means it's not on the path that you thought it would be on at this moment in time. You may be right in the middle of purpose. So being silent may be the Lord saying, you're in the right place right now. Because sometimes we have to wait on the Lord. Sometimes he has to put things in place, get other people to get out of their own way so that they can get in place, so that then you can be in place and the thing comes together. Does that make sense? It's like, sometimes when the Lord is being silent, he is just, it's intimacy. You have to have the faith to know that he's there. I know sometimes we can be in the house together and not saying a word, but it doesn't mean that we're not there together. We're intimately in a place. Just because you're not talking doesn't mean that we're not communicating. Does that make sense? I love the Lord because as he shows me things, it's like he shows them to me a little bit at a time, and then all of a sudden I see it. And it comes from just knowing that he's always there. So that's the key. Even though it's quiet, even though you can't hear or see, knowing that he's always there makes it intimate enough for you to say, Lord, I love you and I know that you love me, and I'll wait and see. Because things don't happen in our time, they happen in God's time. And that's what was going on with Leah, that she wanted him to love her, and the same thing was going on with Rachel. She wanted children, but God is the creator of time, so it's in his time. But these are two sisters. That's the thing. These are two sisters. They're not cousins. They're not girlfriends from around the way who happen to end up with the same man. They're sisters. So there's something here that shouldn't be. They should have found a way to have love compensate for the situation. For love to compensate for the situation, then jealousy has to go away. Then idolatry has to go away because Leah was idolizing the love that Jacob gave to Rachel. Rachel was idolizing that Jacob was having children with Leah. And that could be the same person when you think about it. Even you could just think of it as maybe it was one person just in life. One person could have both those issues. One person could on one hand be happy in one part of their life and then dissatisfied in another part of their life. And instead of thanking the Lord for what they have, they're focusing on what they don't have. And what that does, and what you focus on is what you bring about. It's like, and what you praise the Lord for you praise him, and he will bring about the desires of your heart. But if you complain to him, I can't see him seeing that as praise, because it's not. He gives us the desires of our heart. But if we're complaining, and remember, it's like he knows our heart. And what the abundance of our heart, the mouth speaks, so we say it out of our mouth. So we bring about things that we don't necessarily want because we're through complaints. So instead of praising the Lord and thanking him for the things that we do have and not honing in on, okay, Lord, I don't have this yet, he knows your desire. So he's going to give you the desire of your heart. You don't have to lay it out there and say, well, Lord, I don't have my house yet. Lord, I don't have my 3 cars yet. Lord, I don't have my $200,000 job yet. Lord, whatever. But when you're giving him praise for what you do have, thank you, Lord, that I have my help. I thank you, Lord, that I do have a sister who loves me dearly, that I don't have to compete with in life. I thank you, Lord, that we are all a happy family where we're not picking at each other and pulling each other apart. And that's God's love in itself. So what we had here was a dysfunctional family. Totally dysfunctional, because out of that came the 12 tribes of Israel, which are the tribes that created the kingdom of God on earth as we know it. But they were just dysfunctional. They couldn't see for sin. They couldn't see for sin. They were so busy backbiting and going on that they could not see the glory of the Lord that was around them. They couldn't see it. And they were wondering, I'm sure they were wondering, okay, why me? Why did this happen? Why am I married to this guy who doesn't love me? Okay, I do want to be married, but why doesn't he love me? What can I do, Lord? I'll do whatever it takes for him to love me. Not, Lord, I love you and I thank you for loving me. That's different. That's different. Because what we find is that when we are confident in the Lord, he will bring those good things to pass. He does it every time in his own time. There have been times when I wondered, Lord, what did I do to get here? What did I not do that puts me here? And those were times when I could have and should have been saying, thank you, Lord, that I'm here right now. And I'm looking around for the lesson. I'm looking around for the blessing. Because I've been blessed in places where I thought was desert places. You can be blessed in the desert. I've been blessed in places that I thought were desert places. Then I come out and wonder, okay, and then you can look back on your life and say, oh, yes, right there. I know how I was feeling and what was going on, but I was being blessed. I was learning things that put me in a place where I could go back and do this thing. Or I was meeting people that who would somehow bless me in another area. So it's like we sometimes think that God thinks and acts like us, but it's just not so. It's just not so. He's not a man or woman. So his thoughts are not our thoughts. The way that we think, he doesn't think that way. It's like he already knows, because he created it. He created the plan for your life. From the very beginning, he knew you would be doing this and you would be doing that, and it was going to take all these different scenarios and experiences and things to put you to that one place, that one day where, okay, there you are. You're in the middle of purpose, and you're fulfilling the purpose that he has for you. We each have a purpose, and we each have to strive to find out the fullness of that purpose. Because it may have been here that Rachel's purpose was to help Leah to not see her affliction as an affliction. And it may have been that Leah's purpose was to help Rachel not to see that she was barren was an affliction. Because just like they had the maids to go back and have babies for them and that'd be okay, had they been loving sisters, wouldn't it make more sense that, okay, Leah, all these are our kids. Rachel, all of these are our kids. But that wasn't where their mindset was. Their mindset was on competing with each other. And what it did was it made the whole thing dysfunctional. It made it where they could not see. It made them blind. They could not see the Lord's blessing. Because he was blessing. He was having 12 tribes created. But they could not see the blessing. So what that means is that their lives were not happy. Their lives weren't happy where it could have been. It could have been joy on earth. But instead, it was competition and backbiting and talking about and, oh, I'm going to trade you my husband for some apples. It's not something that I can even imagine living through. But that kind of stuff happens even today. There are people today, there are women who share men today. I remember reading an article in Essence magazine about how they were trying to convince the reader to believe that, okay, maybe it's okay. Maybe it's okay because men, it's fewer men than women, so maybe it's okay, and we just need to figure out how to make it be okay. Well, that's not how God intended. I thank him that there, once we decide that we love the Lord and that our goal is to worship and bless him and glorify him, that what happens in that area is that he will bless us. He will give us the desires of our heart. If we would take moment, I take a moment every day and just thank the Lord. I thank you, Lord, for today is another day for me to give you glory. And I'll say, Lord, what is it that you would have me to do today? How can I glorify you today? And I've had to do that because I've been in a workplace that was dysfunctional. How can I glorify you in this place today, Lord? I've been in a place where I didn't feel like I was in the right place. But it was, although that was a desert place, what came out of it was blessing for me. So sometimes we shouldn't run, we should just stand still. Stand still and look and listen. Stand still and hear. Because the Lord speaks. He speaks clearly if we will listen. He speaks clearly in ways that we may not initially understand. But if we will just, rather than move fast, be slow to move. Sometimes I have to realize that my prayer life sometimes is too noisy. I'm doing all the talking, and I don't take time to just listen. There would be chatter. I'd be praying, and then there's Steve Harvey in the background. So I've turned that off. I've turned it off so that now sometimes I drive to work. It's a short drive. I'll drive to work and just be quiet and just listen. Because the Lord is always speaking. We just have to listen so that we can hear. He's always speaking. And I can't imagine what he was saying to Leah and Rachel while they were doing what they were doing. Because God is the same then as he is today. He was talking, but they weren't listening. Instead, they were doing what they were doing. Leah had 6 boys and 1 girl. She had a girl named Dinah. And Dinah, I struggle with because as I study her, it saddens me because Dinah was the only girl. Now, today we celebrate the only girl. But back then, girls were seen as less than. She was the only girl. And she was the girl whose mother, her father, did not love. So it saddens me to think about how her life must have been. And they tell us about it, and as you go through the story and study it on your own, you realize that her life was not a happy life. And from that I gather that, you know, you draw things to you. You draw things to you. So what she drew to herself was unhappiness. She grew up in an unhappy household, dysfunctional. Her father wasn't around, didn't like her mother. And what you'll see is that the first thing they say about Dinah is that she went out to be with the girls. So there's a clue that there's some dysfunction, that she went out to be with girls. It doesn't go any further than that, so you have to decide for yourself what that means. But it says to me that we have to be careful how we treat people. We have to be careful and show love because it impacts people's lives. It impacts their choices, it impacts their lives, it impacts what they draw to them. And so then you have to wonder, okay, Rachel and Leah, where were you in this? And Dinah must not have been shown the love that she should have been shown because of how her life turned out. imagine if they had been the loving sisters, how they could have grown around and raised up Dinah. But that's not what happened. They were busy backbiting and hating on each other. So what we have to do is know that the Lord loves us, and we have to love each other as the Lord loves us. And that's how we bring him glory, and that's how we help other people, and that's how we change our lives and help other people change their lives. Because there are people who are sitting hopelessly believing that they can't, there are things that they can't do. So when we see those people and we meet those people, we should be doing whatever it is that we can to help them to know that they are lovable. There's this one lady who works for me who does not believe that she's loved in any way. And there are days when she feels like, when she'll put on her false face and she's smiling and she's running around, but then there's days where the depression shows through and she's barely functional. And you wonder, okay, what must her life have been like? Because, see, sometimes church folk can hurt folk. And what she shared with me was that she had been raised by her aunt. And her aunt she called her a Bible beater. And I said, what is a Bible beater? She says, you know, where they beat you over the head with the word. They beat you over the head with the word, and they tell you, going to hell. They said, okay, if you don't get up and go to church every Sunday, if you don't wear your skirt down to your ankles, if you don't take that lipstick off your mouth, you're going to hell. So now here this woman is, who's barely functional some days. Barely functional some days. And it's because hurt people hurt people. So it's like she has been hurt. She doesn't have a steady relationship of any kind. Because hurt people hurt people. She's going through life, but just, it's like she's, instead of living, she's surviving to get to the next day. And I wonder if that must be how Dinah was, because her mother was a hurt person. And hurt people hurt people. So it's like, it's a comparison that I've seen where this young woman who works for me, very much the same, where you didn't have love, so you don't know how to love and you don't know how to accept love. I'm thankful that we have love. I'm thankful that we understand love, because there are people who just don't. There are people who would rather have control than have love. Who feel like if I can control that person, that's all I need. I don't have to love them. I thank the Lord that he has shown us love. He showed us love when he came to earth. He showed us love because he didn't have to. He didn't have to calm down, and he didn't have to make the decision that he loved us enough to come and die for us so that we don't have to go to hell like the Bible beater said. We can choose life. We can choose Jesus as Lord and Savior. And I pray that the people who are looking at us on TV and on the internet will know that they can have salvation. They can choose Jesus. They can choose relationships that are loving, that are not dysfunctional like Leah and Rachel, where there can be sisters who love each other through things rather than taunting and fighting and being and just making fun of people's situations. Because I can imagine that Rachel made fun of her sister. And I don't know, because I wasn't there. I can imagine that Leah gave a smirk when her belly was big again. But we can have salvation, and salvation means love. We can have what all of that means. We can be justified in believing that Jesus is Lord over our life, and because he is, we are. And because he is, we can do, and we can be, and we can have all that we have been called to do, be, and have. We can have that thing that God has called us to do. Is it going to take work? Yes. Is it going to take a press? Yes. But we can have it. We can be the success. We can have the excellence that we're called to have, because we're called to excellence. We're called to be excellent. We're called to do a thing. We're called to do it with excellence. We're called to do it together. And I thank the Lord that you're here, and I thank the Lord that you are a blessing to our lives. And I thank you for the people who are looking tonight on the internet, and I ask you to consider Jesus as your Lord and Savior. If you haven't done that yet, tonight may be the night that you should consider it. He says that if you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, you shall be saved. And it's as simple as that. It doesn't take a big traditional prayer. It takes just saying, Lord, I repent of my sins. I'm a sinner and I repent of that. And I ask you, Lord, to come into my life as my Lord and to come into my heart as my Savior. Renew my mind, Lord, so that I come to know you, not just to know of you, but to know you as Lord and Savior. And you shall be saved. I thank you, and I just give God the glory. We're going to cut a little bit short so that there may be discussion and questions tonight. So if there's anything that anybody wants to share,
I just want to say that I'm thankful. I thank God for the fact that we have love. A family that is loving, a family that is supportive, a family that is functional. Because as we sit here and listen, we kind of tapped and thought of people who are in situations like you've described. And I'm just thankful that that's not our situation, but humbled and grateful, and also charged to do what we can to help people to see that there's another way, whether they're blood sisters, friends, whatever type of family. So,
well, I am grateful for the reminder that there is always a blessing and there's always a reason for whatever season that you might be in, even if it seems like a desert, because God is everywhere and he is communicating always, whether it's very, very clear or if it doesn't seem to be. And so I needed that reminder to sometimes to slow down and to be reminded just that there is a good in it somewhere, somehow. And it may not be for me. Maybe the good is my being there for someone else. Amen. So just to really continue to, one, refocus on God, but to continually stay focused on God and to do what I know to do and to focus on what I'm grateful for, because he knows everything else. Not only does he know what I want, he knows what he has in store for me. So whatever I want doesn't even matter, because he has even more than that in store for me. So I don't have to worry about it or focus on it. I can just be. And that's enough. So I thank you for that reminder. Amen. An on-time reminder.
Amen.
Pastor.
Glory to God in this place. Hallelujah. I thank God for the woman that he gave me. Hallelujah. I thank God for the woman that he gave me. I was sitting over there, probably looking with my eyes all welled up and looking with the big eyes at that woman that God gave me, trying to not cut somebody with the grin on my face. Glory to God. But I was sitting there and I was wondering what it must have been like to be Leah. Wondering, am I like Leah? Or do I know anybody like Leah? Imagine that God has chosen you to birth the one who would save the world. That God has chosen you to birth the one who would birth the one who would birth the one who would birth the one, who would birth the one to save the world, that you would get to be the beginning of the saving of the world, and you crying about some man. Hello? Imagine that you are so beautiful that the man who is going to be Father Israel of the 12 tribes, and that all you talk about is what you don't have, that your beauty has captivated the one who would be the father of the one, who would be the father of the one, who would be the father of the one who would be in the lineage to save the world. And so I just wonder, was I like Leah? Am I so busy trying to work my plan that I'm in the way of God working his plan? And that's what I was. I wonder what. I was just kept sitting there. Am I the father of the one who will be the one who will be the one who will come up with a cure for AIDS? Am I the father of some people? Am I going to birthday parties or Christmas parties and there sits a grandchild that's going to cure sickle cell anemia? Am I that person, or am I just complaining, oh, I wish I could have got him a better gift, or, I wish it wasn't raining outside, it's too cold, I wish we had to wait for an hour and a half to get something to eat. Do you know what I mean? Are we, and I was sitting there thinking, we all should wonder, are we acting like Leah? Because God has a plan for us. And thank you for allowing God to use you to help us. I need to forget my plan. Whatever God's plan is, that's the plan I want. That's the plan that I want. Glory to God. And we just thank you for leading this Bible study. Glory to God. Hallelujah. You are prepared. You are ready. And you got out of God's way. I know you was out of his way because you didn't know what you was going to say this morning about 10 o'clock. Glory to God. It must be Jesus. Because at 2 o'clock, you didn't have a thing to say. Jesus' name. Glory to God. We just want to thank you for joining us for our Bible study. And we love you when you join online. We love when you listen. We love when you call us. And it's a wonderful thing. In church, there's good news and there's bad news. There seems to be about little churches. People say that I don't go to the little church because it's too gossipy. It ain't enough for us in here to have no gossip right now. So that's easy. Well, I don't go to the big church because I want to get to have a relationship and get to know my pastor and be able to talk to my pastor. They say that, but then they join the little church and the pastor says something they don't like, so now they want to join a big church cause so they don't have to put up with that. That it's just a wonderful thing to be at a place where you'll be able to look back and say, I remember when it was just us. To be able to look back. I have family members down the street at a church that has 2,500 at two services, but they can look back and remember when there were seven people. That's the beauty of it. To look out and see you, that's a beautiful thing. The church done doubled in size just like that. You see that? Glory to God. Hallelujah. But the one thing that you don't get to see online when you're listening is what happens after service. What happens after we turn the cameras off? That's the part that you miss. And the only way to find out is to come here and find out for yourself. But we thank you. And as my wife said, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, then you need to make up your mind that today is the day. If you are tired of living the way you're living, and that doesn't necessarily mean that you're living bad, because you could have a good job and be making good money and be birthing out somebody who's going to change the world, and you're just unhappy and you're not sure if this is all that there is. So get connected with Jesus Christ. Accept him as your Lord and Savior. Believe that he died and rose, that you would have eternal life, that he did it just for you. Be saved. Get saved and change your life and allow God to change your world. We thank you for joining us. We pray that this message is a blessing to your life. God bless you. Amen. God's done, so I am too. Amen.